Hello children, in this video lecture I will explain you chapter of Hornbill, chapter 8, Silk Road, written by Nick Middleton. Nick Middleton is a geographer, writer and presenter of television documentaries. He teaches at Oxford University, where he is a fellow of St. Anne's College, a Royal Geographical Society award winning author. He works, teaches and communicates on a wide variety of geographical, travel and environmental issues for a broad range of audiences. From policymakers to five-year-old children, he is writing for all. He is also the author of several travel books, including The Stunning Gift book and Atlas of Countries That Don't Exist and the bestseller Going to Extremes. This chapter is a part of travelogue about the author's travel along the ancient trade route called Silk Road, regions as they are now. This account of the Silk Road, with its contrast and exotic detail, describes the challenges and hardships the author faced while journeying to Mount Kailash on a pilgrimage. Let's know about the characters of the chapter. First, the author. He is a professor of geography at Oxford University and an environmental consultant. Sitan, he is the owner of the car hired by the author for the journey as well as being a tourist guide. Daniel, he is an interpreter from Lhasa who traveled part of the time with the author. Norbu, he is a Tibetan working at an academy in Beijing, who wants to carry out the pilgrimage to Mount Kailash. Children, in this slide I have given important expressions with its meaning. Please write down in your notebook. Let's start an explanation of the chapter. A flawless half moon floated in a perfect blue sky on the morning we said our goodbyes. Extended banks of cloud like long French loaves glowed pink as the sun emerged to splash the distant mountain tops with a rose-tinted blush. Now that we were leaving Rau, Lamo said she wanted to give me a farewell present. One evening, I had told her through Daniel that I was heading towards Mount Kailash to complete the Kora, and she had said that I ought to get some warmer clothes. After ducking back into her tent, she emerged carrying one of the long-sleeved sheepskin coats that all the men wore. Sitan seized me up as we clambered into his car. "Ah, yes," he declared. "Drogba, sir." When the narrator and his companion, driver Sitan and Daniel, they were departing in the early morning, a perfect half moon was shining in the clear sky. Colors of the sky appeared blue. The clouds were in the shape of large French loaves. When the sun rose in the sky, the clouds appeared pink. The rays of the sun were falling on the mountains. The mountain appeared of pink color shade. The narrator and the Daniel were leaving the place Rau. Their host Lamo wanted to give them a farewell gift. During one evening, the narrator told Lamo that he would be going to Kailash to complete the pilgrimage. Daniel translated the same to her. She advised the narrator that he must buy some warmer clothes. Lamo went back into her tent and she had to bend because the door was of lesser height. She brought a sheepskin coat for the narrator. This coat had long sleeves. All men of that area wear similar type of coat. Sitan carefully looked at him while they were getting into the car. With some difficulty, he told the narrator that he was looking like a shepherd. "We took a shortcut to get off the Changtang." Sitan knew a route that would take us southwest, almost directly towards Mount Kailash. "It involved crossing several fairly high mountain passes," he said. "But no problem, sir," he assured us. "If there is no snow?" "What was the likelihood of that?" I asked. not knowing, sir, until we get there. The narrator, Daniel and Sitan took a shortcut route to bypass Cheng Teng. Sitan knew a route through southwest direction. This route would take them directly to Mount Kailash. Sitan informed the narrator that they would need to travel roads that were running through high mountains. He told them that if there was no snow, they would not face any difficulty. The narrator asked the driver, Sitan, what the possibility of snow was. He did not know, he replied, and he further said that they would come to know after reaching there. From the gently rolling hills of Rau, the shortcut took us across vast open plains with nothing in them except a few gazelles that would look up from nibbling the arid pastures and frown before bounding away into the void. Further on, where the plains became more stony than grassy, a great herd of wild ass came into view. Sitan told us we were approaching them long before they appeared. Kayang, he said, pointing towards a far-off ball of dust, when we drew near, I could see the herd galloping in masses, wheeling and turning in tight formation as if they were practicing maneuvers on some predetermined course. Plumes of dust billowed into the crisp, clean air. From the gradually sloping hills of Rau, they reached a huge green plain area between the mountains. Only some gazelles, it's one kind of an animal, were grazing there, and they were slowly eating dry grass of the pasture. They would slightly twisted their face before running away in the open space, and they moved ahead. The fields had lesser grass then. Only stone surfaces were visible in the fields then. Further, they could see a big herd of wild asses. Sitan told that the herd had so far not seen them. They reached the field before the herd could see them. He saw a cloud of dust in the sky far from them. He called it Kayang. When they came near the plain area, they saw a herd of wild asses that was running together. All the animals were moving close to each other. It looked as if a group was doing an exercise in a predetermined manner. Because of running of animals, a cloud of dust was generated in the sky. As hills started to push up once more, then the rocky wilderness, we passed solitary drogbas standing their flocks. Sometimes men, sometimes women, these well-wrapped figures would pause and stare at our car, occasionally waving as we passed when the track took us close to their animals. The ship would take evasive action, veering away from the speeding vehicle. After that, once again, hills had started appearing. Earlier, there were rocks along the way. They saw shepherds who were alone and taking care of their herds of animals. These shepherds were both men and women. They had fully covered themselves with warm clothes. They used to stop and look at their car. Sometimes, these shepherds waved their hands as they went ahead of them. Whenever their path was close to animals, the ship would try to avoid coming in their way. They would move away from their fast-moving car. We passed nomads' dark tents pitched in splendid isolation, usually with a huge black dog, a Tibetan mastiff, standing guard. These beasts would cock their great big heads when they became aware of our approach and fix us in their sights. As we continued to draw closer, they would explode into action, speeding directly towards us like a bullet from a gun and nearly as fast. They crossed the tents of nomadic people. These tents were made as lonely places. Usually a dog of mastiff breed used to be outside their tents. As soon as they saw the narrator's vehicle, these large dogs would have power to tilt their heads. They continuously stared at the narrator's car. When they reached closer to them, they would suddenly start running towards them as At their full speed, they used to run very fast. These shaggy monsters, blacker than the darkest night, usually wore bright red collars and barked furiously with massive jaws. They were completely fearless of our vehicle, shooting straight into our path, causing Sitan to brake and swear. The dog would make chase for 100 meters or so before easing off, having seen us off the property. It was not difficult to understand why ferocious Tibetan mastiffs became popular in China's imperial courts as hunting dogs brought along the Silk Road in ancient times as tribute from Tibet. These big dogs had long hair on their body and were dark black in color. They usually had a collar of bright red color around their necks. They had very big jaws. Their barking was frightening and violent. They were not afraid of the narrator's vehicles. They would quickly come right in the path of their vehicles. Sitan had to apply brakes to the vehicle and abruptly change direction to avoid collision. These dogs, which were as big as a Mount Kailash, would follow them for about 100 meters. When they moved out of their area, they would stop or reduce their speed. Afterward, the narrator and others understood why those dogs were popular among rulers of China. Chinese rulers used those dogs during hunting. Those dogs used to be brought to China from Tibet through the Silk Road. Children, Silk Road here refers to a route that was a famous and popular path for the trade between China and other countries. By now, we could see Snow-Clapped Mountain gathering on the horizon. We entered a valley where the river was wide and mostly clogged with ice. Brilliant white and glinting in the sunshine, the trail hugged its bank, twisting with the meanders as we gradually gained height and the valley sides closed in. Then they had reached at an area from where they could see mountains that had snow at their peaks. They came into a valley where the river was quite wide. It was full of ice. The ice was pure white and shining in the sun. Their path was very close to the river bank. The river and the path had many curves. Gradually, they were moving to higher regions. Side of the valley were then closer to them. Means that on other side of the path, they had mountains. The turns became sharper and the ride bumpier. Sitan now in third gear as we continued to climb. The track moved away from the icy river, rubbering through steeper slopes that sported big rocks topped with patches of bright orange lichen. Beneath the rocks, hunks of snow clung on in the near permanent shade. I felt the pressure building up in my ears, held my nose, snorted and cleared them. We struggled around another tight bend and Sitan stopped. He had opened his door and jumped out of his seat before I realized what was going on. Snow, said Daniel, as he too exited the vehicle, letting in a breath of cold air as he did so. The turns of road were then more sharp. The vehicle was jumping more because the road was not smooth. Sitan was driving the car in third gear. Their car continued to climb up. Then they moved away from the river. It was difficult to drive on the road that was becoming steeper. Along the rocks, they could see patches of bright orange-colored plants of lichen. It appeared that some portion of rocks never received sunlight. On these parts of rock, snow had formed permanently. Then the pressure in the author's ears was increasing. He had caught his nose and blew away through it. They had great difficulty in negotiating the next sharp bend. Suddenly, Sitan stopped the car. The narrator was not able to understand why he had stopped the car. Sitan quickly came out of the car. Daniel also came out of the car. Daniel shouted, "Snow!" He was very excited to see the snow. He blew some air out of his mouth and its color was white, because of cold. A swath of the white stuff lay across the track in front of us, stretching for maybe 15 meters before it petered out and the dirt trail reappeared. The snow continued on either side of us, smoothing the abrupt bank on the upslope side. The bank was too steep for our vehicle to scale, so there was no way round the snow patch. I joined Daniel as Zitan stepped onto the encrusted snow and began to slither and slide forward, stamping his foot from time to time to ascertain how sturdy it was. I looked at my wristwatch. We were at 5,210 meters above sea level. They could see a white strip of about 15 meters length on the road. After that, the earthen surface of the road could be again seen. On each side of the road, there was snow. Therefore, the sudden increase of height along the side of the road looked smooth. The rocks along the sides of the road were very steep. It was not possible to climb the vehicle on this and move ahead of the snow patch. The narrator got down from the vehicle and stood near Daniel. Zitan stood on the hip of snow. He started moving his feet on the snow to move it sideways. From time to time, he was hitting the snow with his foot to understand how strong the snow was. The narrator looked at his wristwatch. It was showing how high they had climbed. They were at 5,210 meters above sea level. The snow did not look too deep to me, but the danger was not its depth. Daniel said, so much as its icy top layer. If we slip off, the car could turn over, he suggested, as we saw Zitan grab handfuls of dirt and fling them across the frozen surface. We both pitched in, and when the snow was spread with soil, Daniel and I stayed out of the vehicle to lighten Zitan's load. He backed up and drove towards the dirty snow, eased the car on it, its icy surface, and slowly drove its length without apparent difficulty. According to the author, depth of snow was not much. Daniel advised that the danger was not the depth of snow. The top surface of snow was always slippery, thus more dangerous. Their car may slip and turn over. Zitan picked some dust in his fist. He spread it on the surface of the snow. The narrator and Daniel started helping Zitan. Soon the entire surface of the snow was covered with soil. The narrator and Daniel remained out of the car to reduce weight of the car. Zitan drove back to move the vehicle slightly away from the snow. Then he slowly moved the car on the snow and continued to drive slowly. He crossed the entire length of snow. It appeared to them that it was not a difficult task. 10 minutes later, we stopped at another blockage. Not good, sir, Zitan announced as he jumped out again to survey the scene. This time, he decided to try and drive round the snow. The slope was steep and studded with major rocks, but somehow Zitan negotiated them, his four-wheel drive vehicle lurching from one obstacle to the next. In so doing, he cut off one of the hairpin bands, regaining the trail further up where the snow had not drifted. After about 10 minutes, Zitan again stopped the car. There was one more obstruction. He again came out of the car and examined the situation. That time he decided to drive the car around the snow. The slope was now very steep. The path was full of rocks. With great difficulty, Zitan was able to drive their four-wheel drive vehicle through these roads. The vehicle was jumping over many obstacles of the uneven road. He negotiated and passed through several sharp bends. Finally, they reached a portion of the road which didn't have snow on it, which did not have snow on it. I checked my watch again as we continued to climb in bright sunshine. We crept past 5,400 meters and my head began to throb horribly. I took gulps from my water bottle, which is supposed to help a rapid ascent. The narrator looked at his watch and noticed that they were continuously climbing to greater height. The sunshine was bright. They had to climb more than 5,400 meters above the sea level. The narrator started feeling a very bad fluctuating pain in his head. Such pain may be caused when someone moves up quickly in the hilly region. The narrator took some swigs of water. It was said that it helped a lot in such pains. We finally reached the top of the pass at 5,515 meters. It was marked by a large cairn of rocks festooned with white silk scarves and red prayer flags. We all took a turn round the cairn in a clockwise direction, as is the tradition, and Sitan checked the tire on his vehicle. He stopped at the petrol tank and particularly unscrewed the top, which emitted a loud hiss. The lower atmospheric pressure was allowing the fuel to expand. It sounded dangerous to me. Maybe, sir, Sitan laughed, but no smoking. Finally, they reached at the top of the valley, which was at 5,515 meters above sea level. At the top of hills, a heap of stones was decorated with white clothes and old flags used for prayers. They all walked round the cairn. It is called a mound of rough stone built on a mountain or a landmark like that. So they used to pray that mound of stone. They were moving around that mound in a clockwise direction. This was the tradition of area. Sitan checked tires of the car. They stopped at the petrol filling station. Sitan opened the lid of the petrol partially. A hissing sound was generated because of lower pressure of atmosphere at high altitude. Volume of petrol was increasing. The narrator thought it was dangerous. Sitan laughed at the narrator's fear. He said that petrol will not start burning, but one should not smoke while the lid is being opened. My headache soon cleared as we carried down the other side of the pass. It was 2 o'clock by the time we stopped for lunch. We ate hot noodles inside a long canvas tent, part of a work camp erected beside a dry salt lake. The plateau is pockmarked with the salt flats and brackish lakes, vestiges of the Tethys Ocean, which bordered Tibet before the great continental collision that lifted it skyward. This one was a hive of activity, men with pickaxes and shovels trudging back and forth in their long sheepskin coats and salt encrusted boots. All wore sunglasses against the glare as a steady stream of blue trucks emerged from the blindingly white lake laden with piles of salt. They quickly climbed down to the other side of the valley. Since they had climbed down, the narrator's head was not aching then. They stopped for lunch at 2 p.m. They ate noodles. The hotel was in a tent made of canvas. It was mainly for the people working in nearby dry salt lake. In the plateau of Tibet, they could find many dry fields of salt and lakes of salty water. These were the indications that once Tibet was close to Tethys Ocean. But during a big change that had occurred on Earth, that area was lifted up and then it was in hilly region. Lot of people were working at that place. Men were having pickaxes and shovels. They were slowly walking ahead and coming back. They were wearing long coats made of sheepskin. Their boots were covered with salt and all people were wearing goggles to protect their eyes from the sharp skin of sun rays. A long line of blue color was regularly coming out of the lake, and these trucks were full of salt. By late afternoon, we had reached the small town of Hur, back on the main east-west highway that followed the old trade route from Lhasa to Kashmir. Daniel, who was returning to Lhasa, found a ride in a truck so Sultan and I bade him farewell outside a tire repair shop. We had suffered two punctures in quick succession on the drive down from the Salt Lake, and Sultan was eager to have them fixed since they left him with no spares. Besides, the second tire we had changed had been replaced by one that was as smooth as my bald head. By the end of the afternoon, they had reached a small town, Hur. Then they were again on the main east-west highway. Through that route, business was carried out between Lhasa and Kashmir. Daniel was going back to Lhasa. He found a lift in one of the trucks going to Lhasa. The narrator and Sultan said goodbye to him. They were at the tire repair shop. While driving down from the Salt Lake, their vehicle had two punctures, quickly one after the other. Sultan was very eager to this repaired because then they did not have any extra tire. In addition to that, second tire was very smooth, hence it was necessary to get the tires repaired. Hur was a grim, miserable place. There was no vegetation whatsoever, just dust and rocks, liberally scattered with years of accumulated refuse, which was unfortunate given that the town sat on the shore of Lake Mansarovar, Tibet's most venerated stretch of water. Ancient Hindu and Buddhist cosmology pinpoints Mansarovar as the source of four great Indian rivers, the Indus, the Ganga, the Satluj, and the Brahmaputra. Actually, only the Satluj flows from the lake, but the headwaters of the others all rise nearby on the flanks of Mount Kailash. We were within striking distance of the great mountain, and I was eager to forge ahead. The Hur village was an unattractive and horrible place. It did not have trees or other greenery. Lot of waste was scattered in the village that got deposited over a long period of time. This situation was certainly bad because this town was very close to the Lake Mansarovar. This lake is worshipped in Tibet. Ancient Hindu and Buddhist culture regards Mansarovar as origin of four great Indian rivers, the Indus, the Ganga, the Satluj, and the Brahmaputra. Only the Satluj river starts from Lake Mansarovar. All other rivers originate from the other sides of Mount Kailash. They were very close to the great Mount Kailash. And the narrator was very eager to move ahead to reach there. But I had to wait. Sultan told me to go and drink some tea in Hur's only cafe, which, like all other buildings in town, was constructed from badly painted concrete and had three broken windows. The good view of the lake through one of them helped to compensate for the drought. But the narrator had to wait for some time. Sultan advised the narrator to drink some tea. There was only one cafe in the village, similar to other building of the village. This was made in a concrete and poorly painted. It had three broken windows. The air was very cool. I could see, the narrator could see a view of lake through one of the windows, and this view reduced the effect of flow of cool air. I was served by a Chinese youth in military uniform who spread the grease around on my table with a filthy rag before bringing me a glass and a thermos of tea. A person from China served the narrator tea. He was young and wearing military uniform. He cleaned the table with a dirty old cloth, so the table became more oily. He brought a glass and a thermos of tea for the narrator. Half an hour later, Sultan relieved me from my solitary confinement, and we drove past a lot more rocks and rubbish westwards out of town towards Mount Kailash. The author was alone in the tent. After half an hour, Satan came into the cafe and they drove through many rocks and refuse, and they were moving in western direction to reach Mount Kailash. My experience in Hor came as a stark contrast to accounts I had read to earlier travelers' first encounters with Lake Mansarovar. Ikai Kawaguchi, a Japanese monk who had arrived there in 1900, was so moved by the scantity of the lake that he burst into tears. A couple of years later, the hallowed waters had a similar effect on Sven Hedin, a Swede who was not prone to sentimental outbursts. The narrator's experience in Hor was exactly opposite to the description provided by earlier visitors to their visit. A Japanese monk, Ikai Kawaguchi, had come to Mansarovar Lake in 1900. He was so impressed by its purity that he had started crying. After some years, Sven Hedin, a person from Sweden, had visited Lake Mansarovar. He was not a person to get easily affected by emotions, but he too started crying after seeing the holy water. It was dark by the time we finally left again, and after 10:30 p.m. we drew up outside a guest house in Dachin for what turned out to be another troubled night. Kicking around in the open-air rubbish dump that passed for the town of Hor had set off my cold once more, though if truth be told, it had never quite disappeared with my herbal tea. One of my nostrils was blocked again, and as I lay down to sleep, I was not convinced that the other would provide me with sufficient oxygen. My watch told me I was at 4,760 meters. It was not much higher than Rau, and there I had been gasping for oxygen several times every night. I had grown accustomed to these nocturnal disturbances by now, but they still scared me. When they started from Hor, it was already dark. After 10:30 p.m., they stopped in front of a guest house in Dachin village for night stay. That night was yet another night full of troubles. While walking around in the town of Hor, the narrator had once again caught cold. Probably it was because of the waste that was lying in open in the town. But actually, the narrator's cold did not get cured even after taking herbal tea. The narrator's one nostril was once again blocked. He was trying to sleep. He was not sure if he would able to breathe through the second nostril. They were at that night at 4,760 meters above the sea level. The height of that town was not much higher than that of Rau. But at Rau, many times during the night, the narrator felt the need to breathe deeply. Then he was getting used to such disturbances during his sleep in the night, but he was scared. Tired and hungry, I started breathing through my mouth. After a while, I switched to single nostril power, which seemed to be admitted enough oxygen. But just as I was drifting off, I woke up abruptly. Something was wrong. My chest felt strangely heavy, and I sat up a moment that cleared my nasal passage almost instantly and relieved the feeling in my chest. Curiously, I thought. The narrator was tired and hungry. He started breathing through his mouth. After some time, he started breathing through one nostril, which for some time appeared sufficient. He was trying to sleep. Then he suddenly woke up. He felt something wrong was happening to him. He felt his chest had become heavy. He sat up. This immediately cleaned his nostrils. He was able to breathe. He felt relief in his chest, and he found it strange. I lay back down and tried again. Same result. I was on the point of disappearing into the land of Nod when something told me not to. It must have been those emergency electrical impulses again, but this was not the same as on previous occasions. This time, I was not gasping for breath. I was simply not allowed to go to sleep. The narrator again lied down and tried to sleep. The same thing happened again, and his chest started feeling heavy. He was about to again sleep, but he felt he should not sleep. It seemed to him that he was again getting electric shocks, but those shocks were not similar to the earlier ones. That time, he was not breathing heavily. He was not able to sleep. Satyakam once more immediately made me feel better. I could breathe freely and my chest felt fine. But as soon as I lay down, my sinuses filled and my chest was odd. I tried propping myself upright against the wall, but now I could not manage to relax enough to drop off. I could not put my finger on the reason, but I was afraid to go to sleep. A little voice inside me was saying that if I did, I might never wake up again. So I stayed awake all night. As soon as the narrator sat up, he started feeling better. He was able to breathe properly and his chest felt good. But when he tried to lie down, he had an obstruction in his nose. He felt something different in his chest. He tried to take support of the wall to sit up against the wall, but he did not get much relief, so he did not sleep. He could not identify the exact reason, but he was afraid to sleep. A voice within the author was warning him. It told him that if he tried to sleep, he may never wake up, so he was awake throughout the night. Sitan took me to the Darchen Medical College the following morning. The medical college at Darchen was new and looked like a monastery from the outside with a very solid door that led into a large courtyard. We found the consulting room, which was dark and cold and occupied by a Tibetan doctor who wore none of the paraphernalia that I had been expecting. No white coat, he looked like any other Tibetan with a thick pullover and a woolly hat. When I explained my sleepless symptoms and my sudden aversion to lying down, he shot me a few questions while feeling in veins in my wrist. The next morning with Satan, the narrator went to the medical college of Darchen. The medical college was a new building. It looked like a place where monks stayed. It had a very strong door. From that door, they entered a large open space. They went to the room of a doctor. His consulting room was dark and cold. A Tibetan doctor was sitting in the room. He was not wearing any kit or uniform that a doctor normally wears. He was not wearing a white coat. He was wearing a thick coat and a woolen hat. He looked like a normal Tibetan. The narrator explained to him that he was not able to sleep. He also explained what he felt during the night and his willingness to sleep. The doctor asked the narrator some questions. He checked his pulse. "It is cold," he said finally through Satan, "a cold and the effects of altitude. I will give you something for it." I asked him if he thought I had recovered enough to be able to do the Kora. "Oh yes," he said, "you will be fine." The doctor finally told Satan that the narrator was suffering from cold and the effect of high altitude. The doctor said that he would give the narrator some medicines. The doctor spoke through Satan because he could not speak the language spoken by the narrator. The narrator asked the doctor if he would become all right to complete his Kora. The doctor replied that he would soon recover. I walked out of the medical college clutching a brown envelope stuffed with 15 screws of paper. I had a 5 days course of Tibetan medicine, which I started right away. I opened an after breakfast package and found it contained a brown powder that I had to take with hot water. It tasted just like cinnamon. The contents of the lunchtime and bedtime packages were less obviously identifiable. Both contained small spherical brown pellets. They looked suspiciously like sheep dung, but of course I took them. That night, after my first full day's course, I slept very soundly, like a log, not a dead man. The narrator came out of the medical college. The narrator was holding an envelope that had 15 small packets made in paper. Doctor had given the narrator medicines for 5 days. The narrator immediately started taking medicine. He opened package of the medicine that was to be taken after breakfast. It had brown powder that was to be taken with hot water. Its taste was similar to that of cinnamon. The narrator was able to identify the lunchtime and nighttime medicines. Both paper packets had some tablets of brown color and round shape. They looked like sheep dung, but the author took that medicines. He took complete course of medicine that day. He had a sound sleep in the night. Once he saw that I was going to leave Sita and left me to return to Lhasa as a Buddhist, he told me he knew that it did not really matter if I passed away, but he thought it would be bad for business. Then Sitan understood that medicines were showing desired result. The narrator decided that he would leave there for some more time. So Sitan decided to return to Lhasa. Sitan told the narrator that according to the culture of Buddhism, it doesn't matter if somebody lives longer or dies earlier, but at their death of a passenger was not good for the business of tourism. Darchin did not look so horrible after a good night's sleep. It was still dusty, partially derelict, and punctuated by heaps of rubble and refuse. But the sun shone brilliantly in a clear blue sky, and the outlook across the plain to the south gave me a vision of the Himalayas, commanded by a huge snow-clad mountains, Gurla, Mandata, with just a wisp of cloud suspended over its summit. After a sound sleep of the night, the town of Darchin did not look so bad to him. It was full of dust and neglect. Many heaps of the broken stones and waste were lying here and there. Sun was shining bright in the clear blue sky. Therefore, he could not have a glimpse of Himalayas in southern direction. The top of the Himalayas was full of snow. The narrator could also see the Gurla Mandata mountain and the highest peak of Tibet close to its peak. There was only a small amount of cloud. The town had a couple of rudimentary general stores selling Chinese cigarettes, soap and other basic provisions, as well as the usual strings of prayer flags. In front of one, men gathered in afternoon for a game of pool. The battered table looking supremely incongruous in the open air, while nearby women washed their long hair in the icy water of a narrow brook that babbled down past my guest house. Darchin felt relaxed and unhurried, but for me it came with a significant drawback. There were no pilgrims. Some old basic general stores were there in the town of Darchin. These were selling cigarettes and soap manufactured in China. These were also selling some basic items required day to day, and these were also selling flags to be used in prayers. In front of the shop, some men had gathered around a worn-out table. The table was looking quite shabby and did not match with other surroundings. The men were playing pool. Women were washing their hair in the ice-cold water of a small stream of river. That rivulet flowed close to the narrator's guest house. The people of Darchin town seemed to be easygoing. They did not hurry up for any activity, but the town had a major shortcoming for him. There was no other pilgrim in the town. I had been told at the height of the pilgrimage season, The town was bustling with visitors. Many brought their own accommodations, enlarging the settlement round its edges as they set up their tents, which spilled down onto the plain. I had timed my arrival for the beginning of the season, but it seemed I was too early. The narrator was told that during peak season, the town was full of visitors. Many visitors used to bring their own tents, so the area of the town increases. Those pilgrims used to establish their own tents. Many times, tents were established up to the plain area of the town. The narrator had planned his journey so as to reach during the start of the season. He wanted to avoid the rush, but it seemed to him that he had come too much early. One afternoon, I sat pondering my options over a glass of milk in Larchin's only cafe. After a little consideration, I concluded they were severely limited. Clearly, I had not made much progress with my self-help program on positive thinking. One afternoon, he was having tea in the only cafe of Darjeeling. He started thinking about the things he could do in Darjeeling. He understood that opportunities were very less. It appeared to him that he had not improved himself in positive thinking, although he had read some books about it. In my defense, it had not been easy with all my sleeping difficulties, but however I looked at it, I could only wait. The pilgrimage trail was well trodden, but it did not fancy doing it alone. The Kora was seasonal because parts of the route were liable to blockage by snow. I had no idea whether or not the snow had cleared, but I was not encouraged by the chunks of dirty ice that still clung to the banks of Darjeeling's brook. Since Satan had left, I had not come across anyone in Darjeeling with enough English to answer even this most basic question. He had many difficulties in getting sleep, the narrator facing mostly, but he had to wait for his onward journey to Mount Kailash. The path of Mount Kailash was frequently travelled by pilgrims, but he did not want to take up the journey alone. The pilgrimage to Kailash could be done in a particular season only. In other season, the route used to get blocked by the snow. He did not know if the snow on the path had cleared. Some pieces of ice were still stuck along the stream running near Darjeeling. That was a discouragement to take up the journey alone. After departure of Satan, the narrator did not meet any person in Darjeeling who could speak English. So the narrator could not know if the snow along the way had cleared or not. That information was important to the author. Until that is, I met Norbu. The cafe was small, dark and cavernous with a long metal stove that ran down the middle. The walls and ceiling were wreathed in sheets of multicolored plastic of the striped variety, broad blue, red and white, that is made into stout, voluminous shopping bags sold all over China and in many other countries of Asia as well as Europe. As such, plastic must rate as one of China's most successful exports along the Silk Road today. That was the situation till the narrator met Norbu. The cafe in Darjeeling was small. It did not have enough lights. It had different section. A metal stove was put in the middle of the cafe. Walls and ceiling of the cafe were covered by the sheets. Those sheets were made of plastic strips. Those were of blue, red and white color. The material used was same as that used for making strong big bags that were sold in China. Bags made of that material were also sold in other countries of Asia and some countries of Europe. The highest export by China along the Silk Road is of materials made of plastic. The cafe had a single window beside which I had taken up position so that I could see the pages of my notebook. I had also brought a novel with me to help pass the time. The cafe had only one window. I used to sit near that window that helped the narrator clearly see pages of his notebook to pass his time. He used to bring novel with him to that cafe. Norbu saw my book when he came in and asked with a gesture if he could sit opposite to me at my rickety table. "You English?" he inquired. After he had ordered tea, I told him I was, and we struck up a conversation. When Norbu came in the cafe, he saw the narrator's book. Through a signal, Norbu asked him if he could sit at the same table. The table was unsteady and shaky. Norbu asked the narrator if the narrator was from England. He ordered tea for himself and they soon started talking. I did not think he was from those parts because he was wearing a wind cheater and a metal rimmed spectacles of a Western style. He was Tibetan, he told me, but worked in Beijing at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences in the Institute of Ethnic Literature. I assumed he was on some sort of field work. The narrator had a doubt that he did not belong to area around Darjeeling. He was wearing a wind cheater. The rim of his spectacles was made of metal and of Western style. Norbu was from Tibet. He was working in Beijing in Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. Norbu had come there to do some field work. "Yes and no," he said. "I have come to do the Kora." My heart jumped. Norbu had been writing academic papers about the Kailash Kora and its importance in various works of Buddhist literature for many years, he told me, but he had never actually done it himself. Norbu said that he had come to perform Kailash Kora. He was surprised. Norbu used to write many essays and reports about Kailash Kora. Some many years, he had been also writing about importance of Kora as per literature and customs of Buddhist religion. But he had never done a Kora. When the time came for me to tell him what brought me to Darjeeling, his eyes lit up. "We could be a team," he said excitedly. "Two academicians who have escaped from the library. Perhaps my positive thinking strategy was working after all." After hearing from him, the narrator told him the purpose of his coming to Darjeeling. There was a shine of hope in his eyes. He told the narrator that he could form a team. Norbu called them as two scholars who had running away from library, and then he realized that his positive thinking was giving some result. My initial relief at meeting Norbu, who was also staying in the guest house, was tempered by the realization that he was almost as ill-equipped as I was for the pilgrimage. He kept telling me how fat he was and how hard it was going to be very high up. He kept reminding me, so tiresome to walk. He was not really a practicing Buddhist. It transpired that he had enthusiasm and he was, of course, Tibetan. The narrator's relief of meeting Norbu was soon disturbed. He understood that he did not have required equipment to complete the Kora. Even the narrator did not have all the required equipment. Norbu told him that he was fat. Therefore, it was difficult for him to climb. Norbu reminded the narrator that at more heights, one gets easily tired while walking. He did not completely follow Buddhism, but he was passionate and he was certainly a Tibetan. Although I had originally envisaged making the trek in the company of devout believers, on reflection, I decided that perhaps Norbu had turned out to be the ideal companion. He suggested we hire some yaks to carry our luggage, which I interpreted as a good sign, and he had no intention of prostrating himself all round the mountain. "Not possible," he cried, collapsing across the table in hysterical laughter. It was not his style, and anyway, his tummy was too big. Originally, The narrator had planned to complete the Kora with those who believed in Buddhism, but the narrator thought about it. He decided that probably Norbu would be a perfect person to travel with. Norbu suggested that they should hire some yaks to carry their luggage. The narrator thought it was a good suggestion. Norbu did not have any desire to walk in the mountains with luggage. He thought he might get tired or start feeling weakness. He said in a loud voice that he did not want to get tired. He started laughing very loudly. While laughing, he spread his hand and body on the table. That was not his usual style. He observed that. The narrator observed that he had a large stomach. So children, here your chapter ends. The author has given only the middle part of his journey. Now from this slide, I have provided you textual question answers, which you have to write in your notebook. You need to learn this too. Write with neat and clean handwriting, children, so it should be readable and you can understand the meanings of each and every word easily. Thank you.